Hi guys, my name is Ashwini Murali and I'm a junior here at Doherty Valley and my speech is called One True Meaning. In middle school, my parents used to leave my sister and I in a daycare
and I hated it, but it was the best thing that could have happened to me because one day I was bored, so I started to write. You hate this feeling of being misunderstood, don't you? This feeling of being different, this fear of not belonging. But let me tell you this, how many great minds were misunderstood much like you? Was Einstein not an outcast? Was Newton not a loner? Was Jefferson not such an eloquent writer? Were they not estranged from society? Were they not different? Well, whoever said being different was a bad thing. Do not let their words touch you. Let them slide off the shield you have built around you because they don't know what they're talking about. They really don't. Instead, listen to yourself. Listen to your heart. You are you, and that is all. They are them, and that is all. This is an excerpt from one of the first things I ever wrote that wasn't for school, but for myself. I was 13 and had a rich imagination, and I was kind of lonely. Toni Morrison said, if there's a book that you want to read, but it hasn't been written yet, then you must write it. So that's exactly what I did. I wrote the words that I secretly wanted someone to tell me, the words that could make me realize why I mattered. I didn't write a novel, although I wanted to. But for people like me who procrastinate more than they work, it really is quite a trying task. Funny story, last year in September, I checked out 3 books from this library. I didn't return them until May. One of the books was ironically about procrastination, and when I turned it in, the librarian asked me if I learned anything, and I said, I procrastinated on reading the book, and she started laughing so much that she dropped the book. Clearly, I'm not releasing a novel anytime soon. I think the reason I wrote so much was in part because I felt so out of place, and I don't know if anyone would understand what I felt or care, so I talked to the only person who could, myself. And I mean, technically, that's what writing is. It's talking to yourself on page in the vain hope that someone out there will read your words and relate it to their own lives, even though I wasn't writing for other people. But underpinning this ache to be heard was the pursuit of something much deeper, the one true meaning. What I mean by that is, I had always acknowledged that there is this force beyond my control, something running through life that could justify feelings, that could give everything its purpose, that could prove the existence of genius. Sometimes I think there cannot possibly be room for such a thing to exist, but at other times I believe in its power because it has helped me. Now, unlike most people, I don't believe that this force exists in the heavens somewhere outside of me, out of reach. I believe that it resides in the cosmos of my head and that there is a way to communicate with it. Let me give you 2 very recent examples that have solidified my belief in this force. I took my SAT in October, and a few days before I was freaking out because, as you know, I'm a master procrastinator and I had not done much studying. My most recent practice test had also shown that I was my scores were much worse than before, like much, much worse than my average. So I decided to do some research, and I found this article that advised me to write a physical letter to my subconscious. Now, I know this seems strange, but at the time I was out of ideas on how to improve for my SAT. The article advised me to set a specific goal, a time frame, and apparently naming your subconscious helps. So I decided to name my subconscious Belle, because I was eating Taco Bell at the time, and so I wrote a desperate plea for help. I set a score range, and I folded that piece of paper and shoved it into my desk and just completely forgot about it. About a month later, when scores came out, I was really nervous. I kept checking my phone over and over again, but mine wasn't updated until 5th period. So I hid my phone under my desk so my calculus teacher wouldn't see, because I've gotten in trouble a couple of times. And to my delight, my scores were exactly within the range I'd specified on my letter. Now this happened a second time too. On the morning of my AP Psychology final, I wrote something along the lines of, hey Belle, I know you're in there. I love psychology, so please let me get the score higher on my test. Thank you. And a few days later, my score was literally at the cutoff I'd mentioned. Now, I believe in logic and reason as much as the next person, and sure, this could all be attributed to the fact that I had been underestimating myself or, you know, maybe it was a coincidence. But part of me wondered at the power of writing and the mind and how it was all connected. So I decided to do some more research, and I found a huge Chicago article titled, Writing About Worries Eases Anxiety and Improves Test Performance. Okay, so maybe I was onto something. All those years, never had I thought about how writing had positively affected my self-esteem. It makes you more articulate, more intelligent, more creative. It makes you a divergent thinker. All those times when people would gawk at how I'd seen a certain connection so quickly, why I was so good at English discussions and essays, why I knew random obscure facts no one would think to know. It was because of my voracious appetite to read and write. It made me curious, passionate, a quick thinker. I've always been afraid to tell people how much I like writing, afraid that people would see me as a nerd or a freak or something worse. It's not exactly something that comes up in casual conversation, not exactly something a lot of people want to pursue as a career, not exactly something a lot of people can get or understand or appreciate, especially at my age. It made me feel isolated, so I wrote about isolated things, feelings that I carried around within myself. You see, something every artist will tell you is that their art is like a manifestation of their own imagination. It's personal, like sharing a piece of you with the world that you know will be judged and hurt, and it will affect you and make you question your abilities. Now I'd like to address a stereotype that limits the way we view ourselves, and it is this, that artists are lonely people. This is dangerous for people to believe, and even more dangerous for artists themselves to believe. I used to tell myself that the only way for me to produce good pieces of writing was for me to suffer and be unhappy. My freshman year of high school, I submitted 8 pieces of writing to the Scholastic Art and Writing Competition, the most prestigious contest for teens. I was particularly fond of these 2 pieces, but when the winner list came out, I was surprised to see that one of the pieces I had not given much thought to had won the gold key at the West Writing a Large Region. The piece was titled The Defects, and it was something I'd written rather spontaneously. It was told from the perspective of a stuffed animal who can think and speak as humans can and who feels isolated because of that fact. He eventually meets another stuffed animal who can also speak, and his name is Smokey. Smokey says, "Sometimes something goes wrong in the assemblage of a stuffed animal. Perhaps it is the cotton with which we are made, or our hearts carved of wood and love words nestled into the pit of our rib cage, or simply the kind of fabric and patchwork that make up our very being, but something goes terribly wrong and we can think and speak as humans can. It is just the way we are made and the way we shall die." The main character agrees and says, "It is rather pitiful, isn't it? And awfully desolate, all those lonesome nights spent staring out into the stars until one begins to meld into another like stone conformity. It is so hard to tell the stars apart, try as I might to pluck them from the sky. They simply refuse to concede." At the end of the story, the mother of the little girl comes in and she throws out Smokey. The very last line of the piece is, "Hello, lonesome nights." Now, when I first wrote this, I had never realized how much symbolism was imbued into this. I simply wasn't aware of it. Funnily enough, someone else had to give me an award in order for me to realize that what I wrote wasn't as bad as I thought it was. Now, the second time I read it, I finally understood that it was all an analogy about how I felt, out of place. Like the main character, I couldn't relate to the other stuffed animals because they didn't think like me. If I hadn't been so lonely like the stereotype had assumed, I don't think I could have written that. But writing isn't always such an intense process. I had fun in that piece too, because I got to write from the perspective of a stuffed animal who gets chosen by a little girl. I get to write about the joy he feels on the way to his new home. And at the end, I even referred to the girl's mother as it. The point is, writing is about taking very real feelings and turning them into clever stories that people can derive meaning from. When I think back to that one moment in my daycare where I first picked up that pencil, I think of a lot of things. Most importantly, that back then my writing was really, really bad, but I can't help but feel that the emotions imbued in those times were more real. Now I feel like I've become so mechanized when I write. I know what I have to say and it comes out the way I want to say it, and I hate it. I miss that imperfection. And that's when I realized that's what the one true meaning was, imperfection. It's the most potent way to drive you to do what you love. It haunts you, and it's beautiful. We are in search of our most imperfect selves in this journey to realize why we matter. Now, as humans, we tend to think in terms of absolutes. I don't belong, I have no drive, no one would want to be friends with me. And the worst part about absolutes is they start to become more real the more you start to repeat them. So here's an absolute that I hope you never stop repeating. You are you, and that is all. There, then, and that is all. Thank you.